everybody. I'm Sarah Crawley, Director of Wellness at Boots, and welcome to today's Live Well panel. Today, we're going to be talking all about food and the relationship that between food and having a healthy diet. Topics that I know are kind of high on the radar for many people as we emerge from a post-COVID world. I'm really excited that we're joined today by Zoe Griffiths, who's the Global Director of Nutrition at WW, formerly Weight Watchers. Welcome, Zoe.
Thank you for having me, Sarah. It's lovely to be with you.
Oh, it's great to have you here today. And I'm super excited to hear more about your journey into the job that you're doing now. And also just, I guess, starting to demystify the world of food and kind of the links between food and weight, because it's a pretty confusing landscape out there, I think. So Zoe, tell me about food and kind of the topic there. So it's such a huge part of our lives and has been before lockdown, and kind of a lot of what we did socially was revolved around it. But I think that sometimes we can forget that food is a fuel for our bodies. And so on that, why is healthy diet so important for our overall health and well-being?
Well, I think you have probably set it up beautifully in your question. Food is so integral to so many parts of our lives. Yes, absolutely vital for our physical health, but also for our emotional and social health. And I don't think we can forget that our well-being is about our mind, body and soul and all of those things together. And food is a part of all of those things. So I know so often we talk about nutrition maybe in the context of individual nutrients or, you know, patterns of eating that are going to help reduce our risk of heart disease, for example. But there are so many other aspects to food and eating that we need to think about when we're thinking about how to support our well-being. So it's definitely not just about what you eat, but how you eat, your lifestyle, your mindset around the food and how you're eating. So it's all of those things combined, I think.
I guess how it makes you feel as well, because, you know, food can be have an impact on mood, can't it? You know, if you're feeling a bit down, you might want to go for something that's going to help to kind of boost and lift you up. So I guess it plays into at different parts of the day and different moods. It can have different roles, can't it?
It does have different impacts. And certainly, I think one thing that we absolutely believe in is food is one of the joys of life to enjoy. So, you know, even if you're on a weight loss program, you should absolutely be able to enjoy the foods that you love, because it's part of life. I mean, that should never be taken away.
Because I think that's a really good point. So how do people do that then? So what's your advice if, you know, someone is wanting to kind of think about losing weight, but equally loves food and gets so much enjoyment from it and doesn't want to lose that? Like, how do you strike that balance?
Well, I would say if I kind of blow that question up to say, what would my advice be to people if they wanted to lose weight? I would definitely say there's two really important factors. The first one, choose something that works. And the second one is make it fit for you. So, you know, there are so many different solutions out there for weight loss, approaches that are proven to be effective and healthy and safe, right through to approaches that actually have been proven to maybe put your health at risk and that aren't sustainable and aren't healthy. And there's a whole host of solutions in there. So what I would say is to do your research to find something that works. What's really interesting, certainly as a registered dietitian and specializing in this area, when you look at what do people do when they want to lose weight? 95% of people try and do something on their own. But interestingly, research shows that if you follow a structured program, if you get support, you're much more likely to be successful. So there's a host of research on WW that shows that if people who go to WW are significantly more effective than people who try to lose weight on their own. So definitely find something that is proven to be effective. And then the second point is all around finding something that fits with you. It's definitely true that no one size fits all for everybody. Everybody's different. And particularly when it comes to a healthy pattern of eating, there is so much research around what dietary approaches are ideal for weight loss. So is it high carb? Is it high protein? Is it intermittent fasting? Is it all of these approaches? And while all of that research is vitally important for us to learn more about nutrition and what works, time and time again, the research shows that the best dietary approach for weight loss is the approach that you're going to stick with. That's the bottom line. So if you find something that you're going to stick with, which probably means not being restrictive, including foods that you love because you want to enjoy your life, then I would definitely say that those are two vitally important things to consider when you're thinking about, you know, how you might want to lose weight and or shift your patterns to be healthier.
Thank you. That feels like very, very solid advice that I think it's also reassuring to hear that, you know, we shouldn't have to, you know, necessarily take things out of our diet as well. It's around that balance and I guess Absolutely. Just trying to make it work instead of trying to do something completely different. And
having something different to the rest of your family or having to buy expensive things that you wouldn't usually. Realistically, those things aren't going to stick and it shouldn't be about something that you're going to start and stop. It should be, what is a way of life that's going to fit with me that I can stick with forever? Because ultimately you don't want to lose weight and have a period of time where you stop and you gain weight. It's about a change in lifestyle for sure.
And you mentioned there that, you know, sometimes that people might end up buying lots of things that are really expensive or unusual ingredients that they've heard kind of can be some sort of wonder ingredient. You know, what would be your advice if someone, you know, if someone's on a budget or kind of, you know, not looking to break the bank, how could they approach this with that in mind?
Well, certainly budget is a really important factor for food choices. I was looking at a survey a couple of weeks ago of around 3,000 people. And after taste, cost was the second biggest influencer on food choices. So no matter what your budget, the budget is really a factor for consideration. And also, I don't think that we can kind of deny the research that shows that often healthier foods can be more expensive than unhealthy foods. And that's part of the reason why, you know, certainly within the more developed communities where we have easier access to unhealthier foods, you know, that's one of the challenging things around, you know, our environment and food availability these days. But some of the strategies that we talk to our members about are things like making a list and sticking to it, figuring out what you've got in your cupboard, meal planning for the week and buying that. Bulk buying things that you eat frequently is a great idea. Focusing on foods that are in season. And some other techniques that we talk to our members about are things like maybe trying to shift some of the more expensive meat choices and maybe a couple of times a week making ways to use things like beans and pulses, which are more cost-effective but healthy protein sources as well. So there's a whole host of things that you can think about to reduce the overall cost of your diet but still make healthier choices. It's definitely doable, but just involves some planning. But no matter what your budget, it's important, it seems to be really important for everybody.
The other thing that I read was how you can actually structure your kitchen so that, you know, you see the things that are healthy up front. So if you do want a snack and you've got a craving, you know, when you go to that cupboard, you're kind of fronted with the healthier stuff first. And you've now kind of booted all of the chocolate into a different cupboard so that
perfect,
he can't get his hands
perfect.
On it.
And this is where the beauty of nutrition science, which is kind of more focused on the what, you know, so maybe, you know, what foods and nutrients do we need to eat, and behavioral science, like how am I going to nudge myself to eat this choice of fruits and vegetables? So things like putting healthier choices more front of mind and more occasional choices out of sight, you are more likely to reach for those healthier choices. That's behavioral science right there. And that is something that is integral to our approach. We talk about the what and the how at WW to kind of make those changes. So I love that tip.
Oh, good. Well, I'm glad that we're doing something right. It's definitely helping tiny hands not get their hands on what they want. So you mentioned up front around the fact that obviously in developed markets, there's greater access to kind of processed foods and kind of quite often they can be cheaper. And we know that the UK actually has some of the worst stats around obesity globally. And I think it's estimated, is it 3 in 5 adults in England are actually overweight or obese? And some of the new figures that we've seen from Diabetes UK show that there are over 3.8 million people living with diabetes in the UK. And actually 90% of those were type 2. So why do you think this is? And do you think it's linked to that conversation we had around processed food and the availability of it?
I think so. I mean, as you said, 60% of the adult population is at an unhealthy weight, and of that total population, about 30% are living with obesity, and it's getting worse. Certainly, we're talking about the adult population, but the stats don't look great for younger people either. And what's certainly true, and what healthcare professionals, the scientific community are really advocating for, is awareness that obesity is a complex disease. It is a really complex disease, both biologically, but within the societal context as well. And there is certainly no one single cause, one single cure. And the more awareness we can bring to the fact that this is complex, it's different for everybody, the more we can focus on what are the right solutions to help support people. And again, that will be different for people. So, you know, we look at the influences on our body weight, and some things we can control and some things we can't. We can't necessarily control our biology or our genetics, but we might be more able to control our home environment within our four walls. So it certainly is a very challenging, and when you look at the stats, it's really concerning from a health and well-being perspective. Many people might have heard the term obesogenic, and this means that we live in an environment now that is not that is conducive to weight gain. So basically, we live in an environment nowadays that makes it easier. Some could say that it's a natural reaction to the environment in which we live. Weight gain is a natural reaction because, you know, you think about lifestyles today, activity levels, people's commutes to work, or, you know, how they spend their free time. You look at food availability in terms of, you know, not only what we're surrounded by, but how frequently we're surrounded by it. Food is everywhere we turn. And, you know, often for people, it's within their reach, you know, in terms of financially as well. So there are so many factors that are influencing. But I think the good news is that there's more and more research around this, more and more understanding about this complex disease, and solutions that can help as well. So I think, you know, we are starting to see more of a focus in terms of healthcare, government policy, and certainly awareness from people that wellness, of which weight is a part, is so important. And people are kind of looking to themselves to think about what they can do.
Yeah. And I think obviously whilst we're going through a really challenging time at the moment with COVID, I think one of the things that's been great is the fact that the government only allowed us to get out of the house, you know, once a day initially to do exercise. I think it really shone a light on the importance of, you know, exercise, even if it is just a walk, you know, some kind of movement for the body. Because I mean, one thing I've found from being at home more and kind of not being in the office as much is I'm not moving around. You know, in the office, I'd be kind of walking all over the place and kind of saying hello to people on the way to meetings. And I find that I'm sitting down almost the whole day, which I know is really, really bad for your kind of overall health and well-being.
But not only your physical health, but your mental health as well. Activity, you know, there's so many benefits to activity, but, you know, you can talk about the physical benefits, but the benefits around activity, de-stressing you, giving you a break, making you feel good, making you feel more confident, is really, really important as well.
So we know that routine is really important to help us kind of maintain our kind of regular balance, but obviously with the situation that we've been in, with people being in lockdown, routines have been a bit thrown out of whack. So how do people help? You know, back to your tip around kind of, you know, staying regular, kind of, you know, sticking to your routine. What's your advice on how people can do that when routines are a bit kind of up in the air?
Well, at WW, we love talking about routine. And the reason for that is because routines are so powerful to help dictate our behaviour, to help support us as we're trying to change our behaviour. And the headline there is that routines and consistency is absolutely vital. When we're outside of our routine, it's more of a challenge to maintain healthy habits. And it's a fact. And actually, there's research to show that when we're out of our routine, out of things that we usually do, we're more likely to overeat. So we have a perfect storm.
Yeah. And I'm just thinking about, you know, when you go on holiday, you're out of your routine. And so all of a sudden, that buffet that you see at breakfast, you probably end up eating twice what you'd eat normally.
Yeah. But, you know, in a way, going on holiday is a chosen, you know, and maybe, you know, an enjoyable outside of routine. And for many of us, our routines have changed. Some haven't. But certainly helping to build a routine within the situation you're in is really important. And we talked about this in one of our virtual workshops a couple of weeks ago, where every week, as well as the support and camaraderie you get from your group and your coach, we have a spotlight on a science-backed technique that helps to fuel your behavior change. So we did this in one of those workshops, and we talked to people about three steps to building a healthy routines that can help you with your healthy habits. So first of all is figuring out what's important to you. So is right now the most important thing to you is helping to get back to the healthy eating patterns that you had? Is it trying to be more active? Is it trying to fit your work day around the situation that you face with children off school, for example? Hello. And then number two, adapt your activities. So figure out what is doable and easier for you right now, because those things are going to be what you're more likely to do. And then make a plan and try and stick with it. So those three steps are really helpful to build a routine around helping you to change your behavior in the way that you want to. And the good news is that the more you do these routines, the easier they become, because they become automatic. So make that plan, keep it up, and it will get easier. But I think without this conscious planning and thinking about how am I going to adapt to new routines and what's important for me right now, it's still unstructured and unplanned. So those are just some of the things that you could do if you feel like you need to focus on your routines right now.
Really helpful. So yeah, just trying to make it work around whatever might be being thrown at you at this moment. And
yeah, and know that, you know, at the beginning it might feel, you might need to be conscious about it. It might feel more challenging, but it does get easier. It really does.
And I guess you see the benefit from it as well, don't you? So you either start to see the weight loss that you're looking for, or you're getting more energy from doing the activity.
And many of our members talk about, even on that first day, day one, the fact you've done the first thing, or the fact that you've done your first day, or you've walked your first walk, it's such a virtuous circle that makes you feel good, makes you feel like you can do it, and then sets you up for success for the next day. So absolutely, kind of seeing the results, but also feeling good about the steps you're taking is really important.
I like that. And so so as we're heading out of lockdown and kind of, as you know, starting to head into the normality, whatever that may be, what impact do you think the whole COVID situation has had on our behaviour and our relationship with food, both in the short and the long term?
Mm-hmm. Well, what we know, we talk to our members all the time around, you know, around all of our countries that we work with. What we've learned is that there's a whole gamut of different situations, and people's goals and focus right now are really divergent, and everyone seems to be different. So there are some people who have taken the opportunity and have felt like it's the right time for them to really kind of double down on their health and wellness goals, and have found maybe being at home, less commute for those who aren't commuting, being around the family more perhaps, something that has helped to support their health and wellbeing goals. There are some people who their goals right now are just kind of holding the fort, trying to just maintain what they may have been doing before, and that is their focus. And then there's some who just can't focus on it right now. And certainly wherever you are on that continuum, may it change hour to hour, week to week, you know, that it's okay. And certainly from our perspective, how we've been talking with our members is we need to show ourselves some self-compassion and just be kind to ourselves. But certainly if you are in that group where you haven't been able to focus on your health and well-being, and you're starting to think that it might be something that you want to, what I would say is that there's some really kind of clever tactics you can use to help reevaluate when might be the right time for you. So I certainly think planning in, thinking about when the right time might be for you. And certainly there are pivotal moments in time where people, humans, are more inclined to change. And behavioral psychologists call these temporal landmarks. It's super clever and makes absolute sense. But things like birthdays, Mondays, starts of the month, start of a season, these are kind of moments in time that we naturally feel we can draw a line in the sand, leave the status quo and make a change. So something like setting yourself a process where every Sunday you think to yourself, you know, is now the right time? Could I start tomorrow? Or gearing up for the start of a month. But, you know, if now isn't the right time, that's okay. But if you want to get started, you could kind of think about using these natural moments in time to help get you started, help make change feel easier for you.
And for those who are trying to kind of lose weight and are on a program or a routine but might find themselves falling off the wagon, what's your advice for someone who's kind of already made great progress but maybe just needs a nudge, like you said, to kind of get back on track?
Well, I think what a lot of people talk about when they're in that situation is motivation. And when a lot of people think about motivation, what comes to mind is willpower. So the mindset of, you know, just do it. Put your mind over matter. And, you know, somehow we've developed this thinking that changing your behavior is all about wanting to do it. And while, of course, wanting to do it is really important and part of the equation, that type of thinking that it's all about willpower, it's just about the desire to do it, is really unhelpful. If you rely on willpower all the time, and willpower by definition is a conscious effort to do something, or, you know, maybe in some cases not to do something, that's exhausting. That isn't going to last long. The bank's going to run pretty low on willpower soon for anybody. And research actually shows that people who consistently make healthy eating choices don't necessarily have more willpower than your average person. But what they seem to do is be cleverer at avoiding situations where willpower needs to come into play all the time. And this is something that we talk to our members about, because there's a whole host of strategies that you can develop that help limit your need for willpower. So of course you're going to need it sometime. You know, it's a birthday and someone puts some cake in front of you that you maybe hadn't planned for. But strategies like sorting your environment, making sure that those healthier choices are front of mind and that the more occasional choices are kind of out of sight. Some clever techniques that we talk about that I love is something called temptation bundling, which is where you bundle together something that you kind of should do to help you reach your goals. Let's say exercise, for example, being active. Some people don't necessarily like the actual act of being active, but if you bundle it with something that you do enjoy doing, you're more likely to do it. So it's not that you have to have willpower to get out the door and go for a walk. It's that actually, if you're clever about it, you'll bundle it with something that you enjoy. Going out for a walk with others to chat, or many of our members listen to their favorite podcast while they're out walking. So they save it up for that time in the week where they're going to go for a week, when they're going to go for a walk. So they're much more likely to go and do it. So there's all these kind of clever strategies you can employ that mean that it's not about willpower. It's not about just getting it done. It's about kind of engineering your behavior so that you know, your desire to eat healthily or to lose weight is supported by kind of tactics around you, so that you don't have to think about it. You're more likely to be able to do it.
I think what you've illustrated there as well is another example of how mental well-being and kind of the emotional side of this is so important. You know, that whole behavioral side of it, making it seem more accessible or more enjoyable by grouping them together. I love that.
Absolutely.
Notion.
Yeah. And I just love that phrase, temptation bundling.
It makes it sound like a treat.
Yeah, it is. And that and that's what kind of motivates people to do it. So I would say, you know, even if you are making healthier choices, but you feel like, you know, every now and then, you know, maybe those things are getting further away from you, then it's thinking about what strategies you can put in place to help make it easier for you. You know, don't be hard on yourself. This is, changing your behavior is hard, you know, so you just need to get clever about it.
And so we touched on treats there, which can often be, I know they can be my downfall, because you just kind of, you sometimes psychologically reward yourself with things that you know are maybe a little bit naughtier. What's your advice for people who perhaps, where, you know, a treat for them is something that they know isn't great, but makes them feel better? Is that a good thing?
Well, I think what we try to do at WW is kind of decouple the psychological connotations of indulgence and treats and food. Absolutely, food is there to be enjoyed. You should eat the foods you love and enjoy it. But thinking about food and using terms like guilty pleasure or treat is something that we don't do, because food isn't a moral issue. There shouldn't be any judgment in food. If you love this food or you love that food, great, you should be able to enjoy it. But I think particularly within a weight management context, if you're trying to manage your weight, or indeed you're trying to kind of have a healthy pattern of eating, you can include foods that you love. And many foods that people love are healthier choices. They're not necessarily the kind of unhealthy choices that we might think about. But within that context, it's about having a program or following a plan where all foods are in, and that within a program that can help you create an energy deficit, because ultimately that's how weight loss is going to occur, but still with enjoying the foods that you love, that's where you can kind of find the perfect medium to kind of enjoy those foods that you love, but also lose weight. So it's definitely doable, and something that we encourage our members to do. We talk about that all the time in terms of planning for what you love.
So I know that there are lots of conflicting opinions around diet and the impact it can have on the immune system. Can you just help set the record straight on this, please? Because I know that lots of people will just want to kind of get the facts and get clear on it.
Absolutely. And I love that you've asked this question, Sarah, because it's something that our members from all around the world have been asking us as well. As a registered dietitian, I know that our profession have been faced with all of this, trying to tackle all of the misinformation out there, which is, you know, at best frustrating and at worst dangerous. So, you know, it's really important to be thinking about what the truth is here. And let's be really clear that your diet cannot boost your immune system. In fact, you don't want your immune system to be boosted, because that leads to conditions like autoimmune conditions or allergies. In fact, you want your immune system to be functioning normally, or kind of functioning at its optimal. And absolutely, a healthy, well-balanced diet will help you to get all the nutrients you need for that. So there's a whole host of nutrients that are shown to be vital for a well-functioning, healthy immune system. Vitamins such as vitamin A, D, C, zinc. There's a kind of whole gamut of different nutrients that are really important and play a role in the immune system. But in order to get all of those nutrients, a healthy, well-balanced diet, which means eating from a range of food groups, having a lot of variety in the food choices that you make, will help you to get all of those nutrients that you need. So there's certainly no amazing superfoods which don't exist that may boost your immune system. That's not what you want. What you want is a good grounding of the range of nutrients that can play a role in supporting your immune system. But certainly, you know, we know there are groups of people who may be more at risk of missing out on those nutrients in their diet. So seeking help from a registered dietitian, for example, could be really important to help you if you feel you're one of those groups that needs guidance on how do you make sure you get all of those nutrients from your diet to help support your immune system.
Well, thank you so much, Zoe, for joining us today. It's been really great to hear more about nutrition as you see it, hear some top tips for people who, you know, are looking to kind of manage their weight and to try and potentially lose a little. And just to hear you bust some of the myths as well that are out there. So I really appreciate you taking the time to join us today.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure to chat with you today, and thank you.